I'm going to show you two problems that men and women cannot solve equally. First problem, the shape on the left can only be rotated into one of the shapes on the right. Which one? Second problem, naming as many words starting with the letter A as you can in 60 seconds. The answer to the first problem is C. Men perform better than women at this type of problem. As for the second problem, there are many possible answers, of course. A typical adult is able to name about 14 words, and women perform better at this task. But why? Is there a sex with a smarter brain? Is there a difference at all? Cognitive differences between genders are a controversial topic. Before the comments section of this video turns into a battlefield, I would like to ask everyone to keep the discussion respectful, and I would like to talk about the complexity of this topic. Even the scientists researching it acknowledge that this is a sensitive and political topic. On one hand, their research is often misused to promote a sexist narrative of male superiority and wrong gender stereotypes. On the other hand, legitimate studies showing differences between genders can sometimes be dismissed as sexist. But researchers argue that there are reasons for us to care about this topic. Learning about gender differences can help us understand the source of inequalities, understand how students learn to make sure we choose the right education policies, and arguably, it can help us fight prejudice. The research for this video was mostly based on these three books, and I was able to get an interview with a couple of experts. I did my best to understand the research, and all sources will be listed on screen. I encourage you to explore them yourself. Keeping in mind that this is a nuanced topic, let's dive in. Starting with the size of our brains, women's brains weigh on average about 1.2 kilos. Men's brains are 8 to 13% bigger in volume. Does that mean men have an advantage? For centuries, this was the held belief. In the late 18th century, a controversial field emerged, phrenology. This study tried to figure out how the size and shape of the skull relates to mental abilities. Early brain scientists believed that women were intellectually inferior due to their smaller and lighter brains, a phenomenon that came to be known among the public as the missing 5 ounces of the female brain. Phrenology was used to reinforce gender roles, and it was later dismissed as a pseudoscience. A larger brain size doesn't necessarily make you smarter. An elephant's brain is about 3 to 4 times bigger than humans, and they're not smarter than us. A major reason why men tend to have larger brains than women is likely because they have larger bodies on average, though the exact relationship is still debated. Nowadays, scientists have more sophisticated technologies to measure brain activity. Let's look at the differences they found. This study looked at over 1,000 brain scans and argues that we don't actually have entirely male or female brains. Instead, the paper suggests each brain is a unique mosaic of features, with some traits more common in women, some more common in men, and many shared by both. Given that all the research that I'm about to show you divides participants in male and female groups, keep in mind that some of the individual differences may be overlooked. Now, let's look inside our brain. A meta-analysis of over 100 scientific studies summarizes sex differences with these images. Blue areas indicate higher gray matter volume in male brains, while red areas show higher volume in female brains. On average, female brains show a larger planum temporal and insula, while male brains show a larger amygdala and hippocampus. You can pause the video if you want to read more about these parts of the brain. However, keep in mind that having more volume in certain regions doesn't necessarily indicate better performance, and scientists still don't know exactly how this impacts our abilities. There are also sex differences in the neural connections of the brain. Men tend to show stronger connections within the same hemisphere of the brain, whereas women have stronger connections between the opposite hemispheres. The results suggest that male brains may be optimized for quicker reactions with a more direct connection between perception and coordinated action. In contrast, female brains appear to show better connections between analytical thinking and intuition, possibly allowing for a more balanced and well-rounded way of processing information. But once again, this is speculative, and scientists don't know for sure the impact of these differences on our cognitive abilities. So, if we can't measure it from brain scans, how do we know if someone is smart? We've seen it's definitely not just about the brain size. We now know the answer is complex and nuanced. The even smarter answer? Smart people use Odoo, the sponsor of this video. Instead of watching YouTube videos trying to figure out how smart you are, why not create a personal website to show how smart you are? Most of my audience are in their young 20s. If you're young and don't have a lot of work experience, having a website is a great way to promote your portfolio and can set you apart from the rest. Odoo is an all-in-one management platform that allows you to build a website for free. All you have to do is follow 4 easy steps. Choose your goal, color palette, and pages and features, and choose a theme. The website builder is really intuitive. You can insert and customize each block using drag and drop, and you can choose a template for every category block that suits your style. You can also easily adjust the layout, resize pictures, add animations or shapes. It also has ChatGPT integrated to assist you with any writing. Whether you need to translate or rephrase already existing text, ChatGPT has got you covered. It's really easy to make a website that looks clean and professional, and your first application is free for life. And Odoo is not just a website builder. They have loads of business management apps to expand to if your business grows. So go check the link in the description to start building your website for free. There's a reason why brain scans don't tell the full story. Your brain is a result of your genetics, but also your environment. You inherit certain cognitive traits when you're born, and your life experiences shape your brain, including your neural connections. So these differences in the brain could be biological differences, but they could also be explained by the environment we grow up in. This is known as the nature versus nurture debate. However, these two factors interact with each other. You might be born with a genetic predisposition for certain skills, like reading, and that might attract you to choose certain activities, and as a result, develop your abilities differently from other people. But because of neuroplasticity, that life experience changes the structure of neurons, therefore changing your biology. We can't separate genetics from the environment, which makes it hard to know which one has a bigger impact. If it's the environment, then that would suggest that men and women are probably not so different from each other. This is Janet Hyde, a psychologist with a background in mathematics, known for her research on gender differences.
I'm the author of something called the Gender Similarities Hypothesis. 37 different meta-analyses went into that article, and it's just a review that shows that by and large, gender differences are small or even non-existent.
Janet argues that the gender cognitive differences are mostly caused by social factors rather than biology. Other researchers, however, put more emphasis on the biological differences, arguing that genetic differences between men and women are key. This is David Geary, a psychologist known for his work on mathematical cognition and the evolution of sex differences.
There is biological and social influences, but a lot of the social experiential influences are actually driven by biological factors.
I think I was quite lucky because I was able to interview two experts who seem to lean towards opposite sides of the debate. They don't agree on everything.
For cognitive gender differences, I don't think those biological differences are relevant.
I think there are a lot of people in academia, particularly the humanities and social sciences, who wish to believe that human beings are kind of a blank slate.
Some people already had their minds in evolutionary theory. And I think that some of them try to bend the evidence so it look within that evolutionary framework.
Fortunately for this video, most researchers do agree on some gender differences, so let's get to them. There are different areas of intelligence, so we need to organize them first. Some people think that if you're good in one cognitive ability like reading, then that means you're probably worse at other areas like math. But research indicates the opposite. Many researchers now agree that the areas of intelligence are correlated and feed into a general intelligence known as a G factor. We're going to look at the differences in specific cognitive abilities, and then we'll talk about the differences in general intelligence. The three traditional categories for cognitive abilities are visual spatial, verbal, and quantitative abilities. Let's start with visual spatial abilities. This includes mental rotation, the ability to imagine objects from different angles, like the task from the beginning of this video. Then there's spatial perception and spatial visualization. Spatial perception is the ability to understand and interpret spatial relationships between objects in an environment. Which of these glasses has a true horizontal water level? The answer is A. Spatial visualization is related to mental rotation, but it also includes imagining how an object would look like if altered, folded, or rearranged. If we fold this paper, hole punch it here, and unfold it again, which of the following shapes do we get? The answer is D. Men show an advantage in all of these skills. That doesn't mean all men perform better than all women. It means that, for example, the average man performs better at mentally rotating objects than about 61 to 70% of women, and that the average woman performs better than around 30 to 39% of men, according to this analysis. Finally, there's spatial location memory, the ability to remember the location of objects in a physical space. Can you memorize the order in which the boxes turn blue? Here, the trend is the opposite, with women showing a small advantage. A possible evolutionary explanation is that ancestor women would forage more often for fruits and vegetables over large geographical regions. In general, men perform better than women in visual spatial skills. But why is that? On the nature side of the argument, differences in mental retention already show up in 6-month babies, which suggests they're linked to biological differences. Some researchers, like David, also point to evolutionary models to explain this.
Males of some species are better at visual spatial if those males have to expand their territory to search for mates in large-scale ecologies.
But other researchers find that evolutionary explanations lack evidence and give more emphasis to the nurture side of the debate.
Yes, on spatial ability, but it's a result of environmental experiences, and we could narrow that gender difference. You can train kids in how to mentally rotate, how to see from a different perspective what something looks like, and so on. So we need to put those in the schools.
Some research suggests the differences could be in part explained by the fact that boys tend to play more games that involve hand-eye coordination, like throwing and catching balls, and that they immerse themselves more often in video games that require them to navigate 3D environments. And now, the verbal differences. These can be divided in 5 categories. Vocabulary is straightforward, it's your knowledge of words. Here, there are no significant differences between genders. Verbal fluency is the ability to generate words. That's the task from the beginning of this video. Reading comprehension is the ability to understand text, and writing is the ability to express ideas through text. Women perform better in all of these 3 skills. There is only one verbal ability where men show an advantage, and that's verbal reasoning. Verbal reasoning is the ability to understand and analyze concepts, usually tested with analogies or word problems. For example, if Bob is taller than Juan, and Juan is taller than Marcus, which person is the shortest of the 3? A theory on why men might find these tasks easier is because they can be solved with visual spatial processing, where men show an advantage. If you picture Bob as being taller than Juan, and Juan being taller than Marcus, you get your answer. Overall, women show a small advantage over men in verbal ability. And if you look at the data, we see that girls outperform boys in reading exams in every country. Women also show some advantages in other cognitive areas related to interacting with people. Research indicates women are better at picking up nonverbal emotion signals. They seem to have more complex emotion knowledge, and overall, they score higher than men on measures of emotional intelligence. And finally, quantitative abilities. In other words, math. Here, I'm not going to show all the details because most researchers agree that the differences between genders are minimal.
Certainly there's a stereotype that men are better than women at math, but that stereotype turns out to be false.
But wait a minute, if we look at the EU data of the people who graduated in science, tech, engineering, or mathematics, also known as STEM, there are only 33% of women. Why do we see so few women in STEM if there are no differences in their math abilities?
When we say that women are low on some of these abilities that are necessary, we keep them out of those jobs.
From a young age, girls face negative stereotypes about their aptitude with math, and research shows that being reminded of a stereotype can affect your performance. Parents show lower expectations for their daughters' math success than for their sons. Girls have more negative attitudes towards math than boys. And even at an adult stage, they show less confidence in their scientific reasoning abilities than men, despite being equally competent. In STEM fields, women face sexism while studying, although research actually showed more of what is called benevolent sexism, like people assuming you need extra assistance because you're a woman. They face sexism when getting hired, being less likely to be selected for certain positions, although there is also some research showing discrimination against men in some cases, so this always depends on the specific context. And they face discrimination after they're hired. And by the time women reach their 30s, they work fewer hours than men due to increased family obligations. In certain areas of the world, women have less access to education, and that also makes a big difference. Research indicates that differences in math performance correlate with gender equality, so I decided to explore some data myself. First, I found this dataset on the World Bank website with the percentage of female graduates in STEM per country. Then I combined that data with the Global Gender Gap Index by country. If we plot the data and add a trend line, we see that as gender equality increases, the percentage of female graduates in STEM goes down. Just when I thought I was starting to understand gender differences, things get more complicated. It turns out there's something called the gender equality paradox. That's how I found David. He's one of the co-authors of the paper that introduced this hypothesis.
And we found that as wealth of the society and gender equality increased, proportionally fewer women went into these inorganic fields.
The theory is that in less gender equal countries, where job opportunities are usually not as good, women might choose STEM careers as a safe path to improve their quality of life, even if gender equality is low. But in richer countries, women have more freedom to choose the careers they prefer. The paper faced some controversy.
I didn't think it was that big of a deal, frankly, because I wasn't that surprised by it. But yeah, it came out and got a lot of media attention. We got a lot of negative emails and a lot of social media. There was a BuzzFeed article, for example, trying to discredit it, not on the scientific basis, but basically their activists didn't like the results.
The paper also led to a few critiques from other researchers on the methods used and a counter-reply from David and his colleague. But now, some reports from the UN already acknowledge this paradox. Some research suggests that women tend to prefer jobs that emphasize interactions with others and require interpersonal skills, and that they may not see STEM careers as an opportunity to achieve these goals. But then again, because of the whole nature versus nurture debate, these preferences could be explained by the gender stereotypes of our society. This study indicates that the stereotype associating math to men is stronger in more gender equal countries. It's an ongoing debate that divides researchers. So, these are the differences in specific areas of cognitive abilities. And now, for the general intelligence, most research indicates the differences are small and don't consistently favor any particular sex. Even though there are no significant differences in the average intelligence, there's a debate about differences in the variability. This is called the greater male variability hypothesis, and the idea is that even though men and women show the same average level of intelligence, men seem to be overrepresented on both the high end and the low end of the intelligence distribution. That means the top scorers of many cognitive abilities are more likely to be male, but so are the lowest scorers. And there are more boys and girls being diagnosed with learning disabilities and developmental disorders. But since researchers don't fully agree on this hypothesis yet, I'm not going to dive into it, and you can read the sources in the description if you want to learn more. In short, current research indicates that there are no significant differences in overall intelligence, but there are some sex differences in visual, spatial, and verbal skills, even though experts don't fully agree on why. And when even experts disagree on the answers, there's no way I have strong opinions after making this video. I do think we should try to separate science from politics, so I sympathize with David here. Ignoring science because we don't like the answers seems like a bad way to fight prejudice, and the findings can help us make sure boys and girls don't fall behind in certain areas. But I also think this data can easily be misunderstood and used to create harmful gender stereotypes, so we should really be careful when discussing it. In 1966, women represented 31% of the biology graduates in the US. By 2012, that number had almost doubled to 59%. Genetics don't change that fast, so society definitely has an impact on the differences we see, and that includes the stereotypes we create. That's my take, but let me know what you think. Thank you for watching. If you like stories told with data, consider subscribing to the channel, and thank you to our patrons.